Live.
Okay, welcome back from Grove Baptist Church. We are live, hot, and rolling. It seems like every time that I do this, it winds up being a catastrophe. So we're going to try to uncatastrophe. So Brother's going to come, he's going to lead us in some music, and then we're going to have some good singing and some good preaching, and we're going to have a good time. So, you'll come, and we'll take care of this.
Good evening. If you would find your hymn books this evening, find page 381. Page 381. Page 382.
Page 383.
getting right there together. All about vision.
How's everybody doing?
Wonderful.
Wonderful. Well, if you have your Bible, please take it over to Matthew chapter 19, verse 1 through 15. And what we're going to do tonight is something we haven't been doing, and that is read the entire text. So, sir. Well, you don't have to stand. I would prefer you to stand, but I'll ask you to stand, and then if you want to stand with us, you may. Says, now it came to pass when Jesus had finished these sayings that he departed from Galilee and came to the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And great multitudes followed him, and he healed them there. And the Pharisees also came to him, testing him, and said, saying to him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? And he answered and said to them, have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore what God has joined together, let not man separate. And then he said to them, why then did Moses command to give a certificate of divorce and to put her away? And he said to them, Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. Whoever marries her who is divorced commits adultery. His disciples said to him, if such is the case of a man with his wife, it's better not to marry. And then he said to them, all cannot accept this saying, but only those to whom it's been given. For there are eunuchs who are born thus from their mother's womb, and there are eunuchs who are made eunuchs by men, and there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. He who is able to accept it, let him accept it. Then look at verse 13. Then little children were brought to him, that he might put his hands on them and pray, but the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. Then he laid his hands on them and departed from there. All right, let's pray, and we're going to get this thing kicked off. Y'all ready? All right, Brother John, would you lead us in prayer, please, sir? So the title of this sermon is Kicked to the Curb for No Good Reason. And obviously, I'm speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ being kicked to the curb. So we see him, and he's in a conflict with the Pharisees here, which is, you know, certainly not something that's unusual to us, because if we read through the book of Matthew, Jesus is in conflict with the scribes and Pharisees quite a bit. He really is going to hammer down on them in chapter 23. When we get to Matthew chapter 23, Jesus is going to pronounce 8 woes against the Pharisees. He is going to hammer them. And so he's not going to really hammer them right now, but he is going to talk to them a little bit. But they are going to kick him to the curb. And I'm going to ask this question. Did they kick him to the curb because he failed to heal? If we look in verse 2, it says, great multitudes followed him, and he healed them there. So when you read that, what's the inference that you get from that? He healed them. How many of them do you think he healed? A few? Some?
All of us there?
I think all. Yes, I agree with you. You said all. I think he healed them all. It doesn't say that in the text. And so, you know, we can't just get legalistic and say, Jesus healed them all. But I can certainly believe that.
Because there are other places where it absolutely does say that Jesus healed a woman. And so I believe that he healed him. I don't think that we could say Jesus didn't heal, therefore he failed to do something that the Messiah should do, and that gave the Pharisees ammunition to kick him to the curb. If we look just in the book of Matthew, I'm going to show you just in the book of Matthew. You don't have to turn here because we're just going to rip through this. But in Matthew chapter 4, verse 24, he healed people of various diseases. If we look at Matthew chapter 8, verse 16, he healed someone who had a demon, and then he healed all who were sick. So the demon, that's one, and then all who were sick. And then in Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, as he was preaching, he was also healing. And then if we look at Matthew chapter 12, verse 15, he healed even when he himself was physically exhausted. I think that's incredible. Just the Lord, he was exhausted. He almost couldn't put one foot in front of the other, and yet he still had the wherewithal to heal those who were sick, those who came to him. And then he also healed not by himself, but through his apostles. We find that in Acts chapter 5, that it says this. It says, so they brought the sick out into the streets and laid them on the beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Also a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people, and they who were tormented by unclean spirits, and they were, y'all want to finish that?
Yeah.
All healed. How about that? See, that's what gets me about these so-called miraculous healers. If they're able to heal, and I don't think they are, but that's just my personal opinion, but if they were able to heal, everyone who came to the revival should be able to be healed. Show me in Acts chapter 5, verse 15 and 16, where it says that Peter charged for his shadow to fall on somebody. Show me where he charged to heal all who were needed to be healed. Show me where Jesus charged anyone that he healed. Nowhere. The only scripture that you can find that concerns Jesus and money is this one. There are actually two, but I'm going to tell you about this one. There's one where Jesus says to Peter, okay, we don't want to offend those folks over the temple tax. So you go out and cast your hook into the sea and take up the first fish, and there'll be a gold coin in his mouth, and you go and pay your taxes and mine. Maybe you would like to pay your taxes that way. Yeah, I'd love that.
I'd just like to pay for the gold
coin. That ought to be good, man. So I think that they didn't kick him to the curb because he failed to heal. I think they kicked him to the curb because they failed to believe. So we find proof of this in Matthew chapter 13. He went to his hometown, and it says that he didn't do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. So I'm telling you, if you're a preacher or you're a prophet and you go to your hometown church, they're going to see you not as a preacher or a prophet, but they're going to, oh, I know that guy. Yeah, I saw him grow up. Yeah, he was a little snot-headed kid running around here. But yeah, I know little old David Hallum. I remember him. Yeah, he wasn't anything special. He was a preacher's kid, like all other preacher's kids, got into everything he could get into. And you know why preacher's kids get into everything they can get into? Because they hang out with the deacon's kids. That's just as easy as it gets. And then Mark chapter 16, verse 14 says, later he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief. I'm going to tell you something. I want you to hear this, to hear this well. Unbelief is not reserved just for those that we call unbelievers, or just that we call those who are lost. Do y'all remember that guy named Thomas? What do we call him?
Doubting
Thomas. Why do we call him Doubting Thomas? Because he said, unless I see the holes in his hands, and the holes in his feet, and the hole in his side, I will not believe. And then Jesus showed up and said, here you go, Thomas. Here they are. You want to see them? Here they are. Yeah. And listen, you have got to love Thomas for what he said next. What he said, my Lord and my God. He recognized who Jesus was. Absolutely, no doubt. So, the second part of this sermon starts in verse 3. Did they kick him to the curb because he was a preacher or because he failed to preach? So what does the scripture say? Does the scripture say that a man can divorce his wife for any reason? Now this is the Old Testament, and the Pharisees came to him, came to Jesus and asked him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any reason? You know why, don't you? Because they were. That's what they were doing. Oh, you burned the beans? You're divorced. That's a really good reason to get divorced, isn't it? Oh, that's dumb as a rock. Well, but that's what they were doing. Evidently, new wives are pretty easy to get. Or else they wouldn't divorce the old wife. And when I say the old wife, I mean the wife that you're married to now. So, I'm getting in deep somewhere now. Just keep going. So, does the scripture say that a man can divorce his wife for any reason? No. But the state of Texas does. And so all the other 49 states, you can divorce your wife or your husband for any reason, or for no reason. Now, here's Jesus' answer from the book of Genesis. He said, therefore, and he was quoting Genesis 2:24. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother, be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. That's Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. So God's plan was for one man to find one woman and for them to live together until death do us part. Now, how well did that work out? It worked out so well that that thing didn't get out of the Garden of Eden. Did you know that? Adam and Eve didn't get out of the Garden of Eden without sinning. In fact, they were booted out for sinning. Both of them. And we call that, listen, we call that Adam's sin. Who started it? Ladies. Who said that? Very good. But we say it was Eve's fault. So what's Eve doing? She's pointing at Satan. And then Adam pointed at Eve. And then nobody's looking at God. And God's saying, you know what? I made y'all better than this. Y'all messed up. Boots them out of the garden. Now, so there's one further word here that the Pharisees surely know. I want y'all to turn there. It's the last book of the Old Testament. It'd be the book of Malachi. And it's a prophetic book. It's a book that you might be familiar with for another very, very familiar scripture. And it's Malachi chapter 3, verse 8, which is, will a man rob God? And they said, well, how have we robbed you? And he said, in tithes and offerings. So, in Malachi chapter 2, verse 16, that's where I want you to look. Here is something that the Pharisees absolutely would have known. And here's what it says. It says, the Lord God of Israel says that he hates divorce. Do we need to go any further? What? We could stop right there. But here, God explains why he doesn't like divorce. And he says, for it covers one's garment with violence, says the Lord of hosts. Therefore, take heed to your spirit that you do not deal treacherously. With whom? With the wife of your youth. That's with whom. Proverbs 5:8 says that you're supposed to love the wife of your. That's what it says. Now, we see Malachi 2:16 playing out in the United States today.
Right.
Because there are so many divorces, there are so many unwed mothers, there are so many children that are growing up in one-parent households. And let me tell you the statistic. This is sad. This is so sad that it makes me want to sit in this chair and cry. 80% of children who grow up in a single-parent household will do so in poverty. 80%. Now, why would you want to do that to your kid? Why would you want to do that to your kid? Why would you want your kid to have an 80% chance of growing up in poverty? Just because you can't get along with your wife, or you can't get along with your husband. So you boot somebody out the door, and when you boot them out the door, guess what you boot out? You boot out an opportunity to raise your children in peace and harmony and with a roof over their head and with love and affection and all those other things that should be happening. Now, Jesus is going to say something very profound here in a minute. And I think we need to pay attention to it. So Jesus actually asked them what is the question that you're really asking. And the question that they were saying was, can we divorce our wives for any reason? Jesus said no. So it says that Moses gave you that for the hardness of your hearts to permit you to divorce, but from the beginning was not so. This is easy as ABC 1, 2, 3. Would you rather be a divorcee or a murderer? Say what? Well, a large percentage of murderers are the domestic pariah. What do you say, Brother David? When a wife or a husband gets murdered, who's the number one suspect?
The spouse.
And guess what happens? About 80% of the time, it's the spouse. Now, here's what I don't understand. How hard is it to get divorced in the state of Texas? It's no fault. You can get a no-fault divorce. You can go down to it yourself. You can go to the courthouse. You don't have to hire a lawyer. You just go to the courthouse, fill out the paper, and in 30 or 60 days, your divorce will say, see ya. It's that hard. And instead of doing that, you know what people do? I'm not getting rid of my money. I'm kidding you. Dumb as a rock. They would rather commit a felony against human beings and against the God of heaven. Let's see, one of the Ten Commandments. Help me with this. One of the Ten Commandments is? Literally translated, you shall not murder. Let me just keep on. I'm just keep digging this hole. So what's the answer? Jesus' answer makes perfect sense. If you're married, finish that sentence for me. If you're married, stay married. If you're single, stay single. There's a biblical exception. And the biblical exception is adultery. If your spouse commits adultery, you are free to divorce him or her. You're not required. Did y'all hear what I said?
Yes.
You're not required. Most people think that you're required. You know, if your spouse commits adultery, then you're required to divorce him or her. You're not required. You're permitted. Now, I want y'all to listen to what I'm fixing to say very carefully. If a woman came to my office
said to me, my husband is abusing me, and I want to divorce him, guess what I would say? Go to the attorney today. Don't pass go. Don't stop for gas. Go straight to that attorney and get it done, and do not go back home. And here's the reason. Because the domestic violence only escalates. It will escalate until somebody did. So it's better to be divorced. Can I tell you that this is my opinion? It's better to be divorced than to be dead. I have solid experience about that particular thing. So the third and final point in this sermon is kicked to the curb because of the kids. Did the Pharisees kick Jesus to the curb because he loved kids? Huh. Jesus brought the little children and rebuked his disciples, who said, "Don't bring those kids over here," and said, "Don't do that. Don't try to shoo them away." When Jesus rebuked his disciples, he said to them something that should ring a bell in us. "Suffer the little children to come unto me, for such is the kingdom of heaven." That should sound a bell for us. Let the little children come. Well, they failed to believe. How important is it for children to hear the gospel? What did we talk about last week? 80% of people who 80% of people who are saved get saved under the age of 18. But would y'all like to just do a little, let's just do a little fun thing. Y'all are great. If you were saved under the age of 18, throw your hand up. Carol's ready, you can raise your hand, you were 19. That's close enough. Now look around. I want everybody to hold your hand up, look around. See that? That's incredible. Folks, if you're looking on Facebook, there are only three people in this crowd who didn't raise their hand that got saved over the age of 18. Rosemary could be actually considered that. But I'm gonna say she's was just 19, so she's all right. It's important for us to focus on children, to focus on youth, to give the gospel to them. My goodness. You remember what Brother Gary was talking about this morning, all those people that were, those testimonies. You know, the one that struck me the hardest, I'm talking about just hit me right between the eyes, was a little girl that got the testimony, and her dad was tearing the pages out of it, and she was putting the pages back. And then he finally came home, and when he saw the third day that she was still putting those pages back, he called his buddy and said, "What's this all about?" And he got saved. I'm going to tell you a little secret, another little secret. These numbers are crazy. When a daddy gets saved, about 90% of the time, the family gets saved. When a mama gets saved, what do you think that number is? It's about 30% of the time that the whole family gets saved. When a child is the only person who gets saved, it's only about 6 or 7% that the whole family gets saved. What does that tell you? It tells you we need to be preaching the gospel to men, especially to fathers. Think about this. I really wasn't going to introduce this right now. I was going to introduce it next week. But I am going to introduce it right now. I want you to, tonight, I want you to, if you will, go home and read the 10th chapter of Acts. And I know that we've been in Acts for a while. We're going to be in Acts for a lot longer. And I just want you to read that story in Acts chapter 10 about Cornelius.
thing that I want you to pay attention to is this. There was a vision for Peter. Peter was told, you are going to go find a guy. When you find this guy, he's going to be a Gentile. And you're going to treat him just like everybody else. You're going to preach the gospel to him. And then Cornelius got a vision at the exact same time. And he said, there's going to be a guy named Peter who's coming to you. And when he comes to you, he's going to preach the gospel to you. And so Cornelius, we're not told that Cornelius was given any kind of command. But he filled his house up with his family and with his friends and with his acquaintances and with his neighbors so that when Peter got there, he wasn't preaching to an empty room. And the Bible records that everyone that was there got saved that day. And so what I want you to do is do, I want you to do this. And y'all just get used to me harping about this, because I am going to harp about this. I want you to pray and ask the Lord to send you to your Cornelius. Folks, I believe that Afton Grove Baptist Church can grow during the coronavirus. I think we can see the church house full, and it wouldn't bother me to move the tape. I would be cool with that, but I'm all right with the tape being there too. So whatever we want to do is good with me. I'm telling you, I think the church can grow, but it's only going to grow if we want to work to get the church to grow.
Yeah.
And I think it starts. And that thing that Brother Gary was talking about this morning, a four-letter word. Remember what he said? Usually, we use prayer as a last resort. And if we use prayer as a first resort, there wouldn't be a last resort. Woo! Lord, that was good. That might go in my journal somewhere.
Yes.
I like that. That was good. Now, it's important for us to make sure that adults hear the gospel, men and women, that children hear the gospel, boys and girls, and that we get them to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. But Larry will remember this when we were little boys. He and I did not grow up together, but I know that he grew up in a BMA church. And we had a group called the Galileans. And the Galilean theme song was Footsteps of Jesus. And I remember when I learned how to play the piano, our Galilean leader, he wanted me to play Footsteps of Jesus. And I finally mastered that thing. It's in three planes. And so, Ms. Thomas was like, that was hard for me because I just barely had learned how to play in one plan. And so I remember Brother Bill, big tears welling up in his eyes. And when I played Footsteps of Jesus, and the little 8 or 10 of us, Galilean boys, and we were in there singing Footsteps of Jesus, and I was clanking on the piano. I'm telling you, I was playing more in between the keys than I played on the key, but I got through. I got through Footsteps of Jesus. Let's pray for our Cornelius. All right. We're going to conclude right there. And I'm just going to say to the Facebook crowd, may the Lord bless you. And the rest of you, I'm going to say I love you. Appreciate you. We're going to have Brother Larry come up, and he's going to lead us in a song. And if you have prayer requests, then